festival is a teamwork. It's not a one-man show. If you don't have a good team, it's difficult to do this kind of precision. Dr. Kouvelos.
Thank you, dear Chairman, dear colleagues. In the next 10 minutes, I'm going to present you our 3 years' experience regarding the Chimney-Ivar technique. As we know, Chimney-Ivar for treatment of pararenal triplets have been considered an established endovascular approach. We have, we all know about these studies, the Protagoras and the Pericles registry. They have, these are the studies that actually established this method for treatment of these patients. And back in 2016, we initiated our CHIVAR program from the May till the September. This is the results I'm going to present you, 41 months. We did 33 Chimney-Ivars, and this was the proportion of 16% of all the abdominal aortic aneurysm endovascular repair we did during this period. The patient selection, these were patients with proximal lactic zones that precluded any standard IVAR attempt. These were patients that were at high risk for an open repair. However, when FIVAR or BIVAR was indicated, we also considered, besides the cost of the FIVAR-BIVAR procedure, the patient decision to deny a long waiting of 4 to 8 months. This is the waiting for a FIVAR-BIVAR usually in Greece for the custom-made endograft to be made. And in these patients, we always make a central line for the aorta itself and for each target vessel we want to consider inside the Chimney-Ivar technique. This is the aorta, centrolumen line. We can easily, actually, in this plan, measure the diameters and the length, and this is the centrolumen line for the SMA. And all patients were under general anesthesia. We used the cerebral oximetry. Professor Anatoglou will really tell us a lot about these modalities. And also heparin and active ACT control every 30 minutes. The ACT target was above 200 to 300. And if this goal was not achieved, we further bolus of heparin was considered. This is the patient position. As you can see, we have access to both femorals and auxiliary arteries. And if you want to go for two chimneys, we usually puncture and prepare the left arm and use two sheaths in this modality. And if we go for a triple chimney, we use this modality, two from the left arm and one for the right arm. And this is an intraoperative image of the two sheaths inside the left arm for doing a double chimney procedure. All patients double antiplatelet, dual antiplatelet therapy, clopidogrel and aspirin, at least for 1 month. The exception is those patients that had that were under DOACs or VKAs, where we choose a single antiplatelet treatment plus the DOAC regimen. The duration of the double antithrombotic therapy was reevaluated in first and six-month of follow-up period. We also use a standardized protocol regarding the follow-up, CTA, CTA angiography during the first month, at 12 months and yearly thereafter. And if the first month CTA is good, we follow the patient with a color duplex ultrasonography plus plain X-rays in the six-month follow-up. And of course, in every visit, laboratory tests in each evaluation. So we did 26 patients with a primary treatment. These were patients having AAA without an endograft, and 7 patients that have a previous aortic procedure, one with a previous open repair. He was treated for paranastomotic aneurysm, and 6 cases with a previous failed IVAR. All patients had endolic type 1. The target vessels we treated 57 renal and 15 superior mesenteric arteries. 9 patients had a single chimney procedure, 9 patients a double chimney procedure, and 15 patients a triple chimney procedure. About the endograft that we used, 21 patients had an endurant endograft, 9 patients an helix, 2 patients an ingraft, and 1 patient a Bolton relay endograft. Target vessel grafts, 55 balloon expandable for the renal arteries. You can see big graft, atrium, live stream, and 1 VBX, and 2 self-expandables for the renal arteries in 1 patient. And we also used 15 balloon expandable stents for the superior mesenteric artery. In nearly 24 patients, we realigned these balloon expandable stent grafts with a self-expandable bare metal stent. This was, we feel in many times liberal to use this realigning procedure, the method, just to, in patients that have a severe angulation of the target vessel stent graft, and we want to secure more accurately the configuration of the chimney EVAR target vessels. The median perioperative time was around 200 minutes, the radiation exposure around 44 minutes, the median contrast volume we used 200 ml, and the median stay at ICU only 1 day for all patients. 30-day mortality was 8%. We had 3 deaths, 1 death from an excessive seizure. He was a patient that really had a severe inflammatory response in the procedure for the endografts. He died at the 4th day from multi-organ failure syndrome. However, in the CTA that we did during this event, the target vessels of these patients, the grafts were patent. We had also 2 AMIs, acute myocardial infarctions, at the 2nd and 5th post-op day. And the 30-day morbidity was 70%. We had 6 patients, included 2 strokes and 1 acute myocardial infarction. During the follow-up period, at the 6th month, we have 1 real stent occlusion. The patient was asymptomatic and remained asymptomatic with slightly elevated creatinine level of 1.7. We had also 2 stenoses, 1 in the SMA and 1 in the renal artery, and 2 interventions. 1 intervention was due to the SMA restenosis, and 1 limb relining due to endoleg type 3. And in the next slides, you can see the procedure of the intervention of the SMA stenosis. This is the stenosis of the stent graft in the SMA. We achieved to catheterize this stent graft and put a balloon, and this is the final result, which is very, very good. We had also 3 gutter endolics, 1 all resolved the 1st month. These endolics usually are low flow endolics. They are not associated with sunk enlargement. They have a tendency to disappear, and this happened to all of these patients. We had also 2 type A endolics, type 1 endolic, and these patients they are still under close surveillance until today, with no significant sac enlargement. The cumulative survival was around 43% at 24 months, while the cumulative patency during the follow-up period was 95% at 2 years of follow-up period. And here is a couple of cases. You can see here this perineal aneurysm with a mild, I would say, angulation. And this is the result, the endurance stent graft along with 3 chimneys in 2 renal arteries and 1 SMA. This is the follow-up CT scan in a very good result. Another patient with this aneurysm, perineal aneurysm, And we did an ELIX procedure, CHIVAS procedure, with two chimneys with a very good result. And this is another patient, this is the same patient. We can see the configuration of the target vessel stent grafts and the ELIX device, very good result. And this is another patient with a previous aortic endograft, a type 1 endolic, and a migration of the graft. And you can see we did a CHIVAS procedure inside the previous endograft. We put an ELIX endograft and did one chimney. So based on that experience, in the last 6 months, this patient were not included in this presentation. However, we also did a couple of cases of rupture EVAR. You can see here is a patient with a rupture AAA, and he had also a previous endograft. This is on he had an endolic and rupture, and we did a single chimney procedure. First month coral duplex was okay with no endolic and adequate seal. And this is the X-ray that we did in this patient. We did not want a CTA in this patient for the follow-up because he had a severe renal impairment. And this is another patient with also a rupture of AAA, and he also had a previous aortic endograft, and we did a double chimney in this patient with a very good results for the first CTA of the first month. So my conclusion, dear Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, the chimney technique allows the endovascular treatment of paranuclear aneurysm according to each patient's specific anatomy. It seems a procedure that is feasible and a safe option, at least during the mid-term follow-up period, based on our experience. However, despite the minimal invasive nature of the procedure, these patients remain fragile and need a meticulous perioperative care. Thank you very much.
Thank you, George, for the nice presentation.